Welcome to the broadcast tonight. A look at the new political season, the 2006 congressional elections, with Mark Halperin of ABC News, Adam Nagourney of the New York Times, and Michael Duffy of Time magazine.
In the last few weeks, Republicans have narrowed some of the asymmetries between them and the Democrats where they were behind, and I think they've increased some of the asymmetries where they were already ahead. So still up in the air if Democrats will take the House back or not, less of a chance they'll take the Senate, but I think the last week or so have seen Republicans make gains, and those gains are kind of snowballing to give them more confidence. And I think one thing the Democratic Party has to worry about is at the elite level and the mass level that they don't enter the election season with enough confidence.
I've thought all along that the two main advantages that the Republican Party has over the Democratic Party, which are huge, are money and turnout, okay? They've been spending the past 4 years developing a turnout operation, which I think we saw it proved again by the victory of Senator Chafee in Rhode Island. They sent their 72-hour team. That's what it's called up there. They had the highest turnout in Rhode Island Republican history, Republican primary history. We saw it in that special election in California, Duke Cunningham's seat. You know, again, where in adverse circumstances, Republican won because of that turnout operation. Democrats cannot, as far as I can tell, match that turnout operation. And if it's a close election, that could really be key.
In the last 10 days, the president has just raised the stakes on the election, really making an attempt to make it not about Iraq, but to make it about the future of Western civilization.
Right.
I mean, he's really raised the stakes on the whole contest in a way that's changed it, I think. And you can see that a little bit in his polls. They've picked up a little bit his approvals. The Republican interest in the race has gone up. The base of the Republican Party, which was a little asleep through most of the summer, has clearly awakened.
Also this evening, David Kaplan of Newsweek, who wrote the cover story about Hewlett-Packard.
What was astonishing here is, one, these were the directors being hacked, not some lowly employee, and it was their home phone records. It's that invasion of privacy that I think surprised me and has infuriated everyone else. And the fact that it was reporters as well, and now we learn that it wasn't just phone records, they were followed, they were photographed. I've heard that there were movies taken of who was meeting with whom. So the level of the invasion of privacy, with each day, we learn a little bit more.
Mark Halperin, Michael Duffy, Adam Nagourney, and David Kaplan coming up. Funding for Charlie Rose has been provided by the following.
For every drop of yourself you give, get every drop back. We offer over 80 ways to hydrate, energize, nourish, relax, or enjoy every drop of life.
Charlie Rose on PBS is brought to you in part by J.P. Morgan Chase, providing financial services and solutions to more than 30 million consumers, institutions, corporations, and governments worldwide.
Additional funding for Charlie Rose was also provided by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
Studios in New York City. This is Charlie Rose.
We begin this evening with the fall political season and a look at the midterm elections. The war in Iraq and security issues are playing a major role in the campaigns. Joining me now from Washington, Adam Nagourney, national political correspondent for the New York Times. Also Michael Duffy, assistant managing editor of Time magazine. With me here in New York, Mark Halperin, political director of ABC News. Welcome all.
Welcome.
So I began here in New York. So where do we stand at this moment with respect to where we are in the primary season heading for November 2006?
Right. We have just a couple states that are left to vote, and I think the fields are pretty set. The way I'm looking at this is the way I try to always do it. What are the asymmetries? Where is one side ahead, the other side behind? And I think in the last few weeks, Republicans have narrowed some of the asymmetries between them and the Democrats where they were behind, and I think they've increased some of the asymmetries where they were already ahead. So still up in the air if Democrats will take the House back or not, less of a chance they'll take the Senate, but I think the last week or so have seen Republicans make gains, and those gains are kind of snowballing to give them more confidence. And I think one thing the Democratic Party has to worry about is at the elite level and the mass level that they don't enter the election season with enough confidence.
They have to worry about that. They don't have confidence.
I think that they have tried, they are Charlie Brown, and they've tried to kick that football against George Bush and Karl Rove three times now. It's been pulled away every time. they think they can win. They think they've got stuff in place to win on a technical level, on an issues level. But I think we've seen the Republicans get some of that confidence back, less disunity between the Republicans on the White House and Republicans on Capitol Hill. I think that's a looming danger because confidence matters in this stuff. It's a lot about psychology. It's a lot about confidence. I think that's a danger for them now.
Adam, what would you add to that?
A couple of things. One is, I'm not sure we're at that point yet. I think one of the key questions here is, do Democrats take the bait from the White House on the terrorism surveillance bill that's being pushed on the Hill? So far, they have not, and so far, they've been getting something of a protection from Republicans who have sort of distanced themselves from the White House on that issue. That's the first point. But where I definitely agree is I've thought all along that the two main advantages that the Republican Party has over the Democratic Party, which are huge, are money and turnout, okay? They've been spending the past 4 years developing a turnout operation, which I think we saw it proved again by the victory of Senator Chafee in Rhode Island. They sent their 72-hour team. That's what it's called up there. They had the highest turnout in Rhode Island Republican history, Republican primary history. We saw it in that special election in California, Duke Cunningham's seat. You know, again, where in adverse circumstances, Republican won because of that turnout operation. Democrats cannot, as far as I can tell, match that turnout operation. And if it's a close election, that could really be key. Plus, they have tons more money. So that, to me, are the two main things. I think that's more strong in the issue environment that Mark's referring to.
Michael?
Two factors. One already we've seen and one I think we haven't seen. The one we've seen is in the last 10 days, the president has just raised the stakes on the election, really making an attempt to make it not about Iraq, but to make it about the future of Western civilization.
Right.
I mean, he's really raised the stakes on the whole contest in a way that's changed it, I think. And you can see that a little bit in his polls. They've picked up a little bit his approvals. The Republican interest in the race has gone up. The base of the Republican Party, which was a little asleep through most of the summer, has clearly awakened. And you can see that. And the second is the unseen factor is related to what both Mark and Adam are talking about, and that is money not just on turnout but on ads. Mm-hmm. The Republicans are going to pour untold amount of money into ads. It hasn't happened yet. I was talking to somebody who's running a state Senate race in Indiana. He's talking about $500,000 in a state Senate race in ads he hasn't spent yet. These are unbelievable numbers, and we haven't even seen that wave hit yet. So that's another sort of direction to look for in terms of what's still to come. And as you noticed probably this week, the Democrats are still arguing about who's going to spend what money and how much they might get, and they seem behind on that score, too.
It is said, these are some of the conventional wisdom about all this, and I just want to put it on the table. Number one, if this is an election, this 2006 congressional election, is a referendum on George Bush, Democrats win. If this is a referendum on the Iraq War, Democrats win. If it's a referendum on national security, Republicans win. Is that the way it is?
I think there's more issues than that. I think you can get into kind of a false choice if you think about, is this going to be a national election or decided on local issues? Is this an election where you're trying to appeal to your base or you're trying to appeal to the center? Sophisticated political operations know they've got to do both. And I think, again, the Republicans, because they've got more money for TV, they've got the bully pulpit of the White House, and they've got that micro-targeting expertise that Adam talked about in Rhode Island, they're probably tactically and mechanically better suited, better equipped to do both those things, local, national, center, base at the same time. Clearly, the Democrats' best opportunity is to talk about change. And that's been, in the 6 year of a presidency, the message that's worked. The question is, can the Republicans trump that with the things where they have a bigger advantage? And again, it's moving target. We're not on election day. But I would say right now, what you said is true, but I think that's just part of the picture. Clearly, Iraq is a bad issue for the president. But other things that were bad issues, gas prices, the economy, perhaps the prescription drug benefit for Medicare, mm-hmm. perhaps immigration even, could end up being good issues for Republicans, whereas a few months ago, they looked like they were calamitous and grouped with Iraq.
Go ahead, somebody.
I was going to second what Mark said on one point here. I think the way to understand this election is, I agree with all that stuff about the environment, but can the Republican tactical money get out the vote and just better sort of strategic expertise advantage counter a bad environment? Because it's just a question of, I think, Mark, how bad the environment is. Is it really bad with gas prices going back up over $3? Seems unlikely. Or is it just kind of bad? But to me, all along, that's what this election has been about. Can what the Republican machine has been building for the past couple of years trump this bad environment, which is why it's such an interesting election to me.
And how much of a fact, even though it is often said all politics is local, I mean, this is clearly national issues over the most recent history have played a much stronger role. How much of it is a fact that I think the president has the bully pulpit? The president can go to Congress and say, you know, we need to spy on people. We need to do whatever. We need to have certain executive privileges or authority in order to do the job because Western civilization is at stake, and I'm leading the battle against terrorism as the prime protector of Western civilization. The Democrats don't have anybody that can respond to that.
They don't have.
Because they don't even know what they, how they want to respond.
The White House may be wrong, but the White House welcomes the response coming from Nancy Pelosi, Howard Dean, and Harry Reid. They may be underestimating them, but they welcome it. Look, last week the president had 9/11, the anniversary, or this week rather. Next week he'll have
UN.
The UN.
Right.
That's 2 weeks when almost all the discussion, including on Capitol Hill with these fights, including some between Republicans, but nonetheless, the national debate is about national security, fighting terror. It's not about how many Americans are dying in Iraq. It's not about health care. It's not about the Medicare prescription drug benefit and its potential flaws. It is about national security and, as we said at the beginning, about the stakes which the president is escalating. They only need to do it one more time, as far as the Bush White House is concerned, to go to that well, and they're trying to. They're not giving up on controlling the issues environment. They're not just going to rely on tactics and mechanics.
Yeah. Right, Mark, I'm not saying they're giving up on it. I'm just saying it's more difficult. I do agree in this environment. I do agree, though, that they have vast advantages over the Democrats, at least in terms of having the White House, in terms of what the Democrats have to put up against the White House on controlling the agenda, as we've seen for the past 2 weeks.
Other than national security, what's the most important issue, Michael?
Well, I think we haven't seen them play all of their issue cards yet. It's quite possible that before this is over, they will get to Harry Reid and Nancy Pelosi and make issues out of them as well. This is just, you know, by their reckoning, a couple of weeks going here. I think the most important fact, sort of outside of national security and domestic affairs, that's happened for the president since, you know, in the last couple of weeks, is the fact that you can now get gas in Ohio for just about $2 a gallon. This was about $3 a gallon a month ago. It's fallen into the low twos around the state. This is good news for the Republican Party because it was killing them before. But as I say, you know, this is a little bit like a football game. What the plays they run later in the game may not look like the plays they're running right around 9/11 and the opportunities they have now. So it'll change.
Does the economy cut for the president? I mean, the president runs around and says frequently, we're not getting credit for the economy. The economy is much better than a lot of people thought it would be. The deficit did go down a bit, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
Well, he hasn't got, you know, I don't think the Republicans really want to talk about the economy because it's not a clear picture. And they'd rather talk about something that's, you know, black and white, straightforward, and works for them.
Which is national security.
Yeah, absolutely. So I just don't think that's going to be the one they tee up. What they'll tee up is something a little different. It's more like if we turn the House over to the Democrats, we're going to see inquiries and we're going to see possibly other kinds of investigations. That's a real base builder, really gets out the Republican base. You know, I think it was Ken Melman or someone had written a memo a couple of weeks ago about anger points. And anger points are things you deploy in an election that actually build your base and get them to the polls. That was one of the biggest ones that worked for the Republicans. And I think we'll see that before this is over.
We're also going to see, if you're looking at some of the ads now, you're going to see you'll see some familiar old Republican attacks, which I think still work. Democrats as big taxers. There's a lot of immigration ads out there now as well. And in fact, we are seeing Nancy Pelosi in some ads too. And you get a hint of where these guys might be going. My experience with this team is that they tend to plan out a campaign week by week in terms of how they want it to play. You know, 1 week might be, or in this case, Mark, 2 weeks would be national security, where you'd have some sort of interaction between television commercials and what's going on the ground. Obviously, that's harder to do with the congressional race than the White House race, but I think that's the way we have to think about this as well.
Here's why I'm confused. I just read a story in the paper, either this weekend or last weekend, about Karl Rove, and this whole story said the Republicans aren't listening to Karl Rove like they used to. I mean, because they've got all these challenges. I mean, but you seem to be suggesting a strategy that comes right out of Karl Rove's playbook.
Right. Well, I don't think that a lot of the guys out in the field are playing by that strategy. Like, you don't see, and we'll see whether it changes, but you don't see very many examples of Republican candidates, say, talking about the war and embracing it, which is one thing Rove was talking about earlier, and not even talking about national security so much. And you do see them just saying, we'll do what we need to do to win.
So you have essentially the White House on a national basis trying to sound themes that will keep its base active and interested and ready to come out. But on a local level, you'll see Republicans talk about other things and certainly not talk necessarily about the future of Western civilization or whatever issue.
Let me just raise this before you jump in. It is last night I had David Remnick, who just wrote a long piece in the New Yorker magazine about travels with Bill Clinton, in which he got into everything, in everything, in terms of the fact that Clinton couldn't do some of the things he wanted to do because he didn't want to, you know, she had a possible presidential campaign soon to be underway, and so are already underway, soon to be flowering. If Bill Clinton, and you, and you've got a new book coming out whose title is?
The Way to Win, thank you for asking.
The Way
October,
to Win.
October 3rd.
All right. Pub date, October 3rd.
Made the publisher mark.
We're at the good people at Random
But would you interview Bill Clinton and you interviewed Karl Rove and other people, right?
Right.
All right. Would the Democrats benefit if they could just say, Bill Clinton, unleash him, let him go make the case?
I'd put him in a war room at a minimum, maybe not put him front and center, but he certainly can give good advice. And of course,
but are they doing that?
Well, the guy who's running the House Republican, the House Congressional Campaign Committee, Rahm Emanuel, worked for Bill Clinton and certainly understands.
And Clinton just endorsed his book big time.
Exactly. Now, for instance, one of the things that Karl Rove does that the candidates this year are doing, whether they're coordinating with Karl Rove every bit as much as before or not, they've done a lot of research on the Democrats who are running. And I bet you a lot of the Democratic candidates, these challengers, people running for open seats, they've got what they call in the business votes and quotes in the past that they don't even know about, that the Republicans will turn into saying they are going to raise your taxes. That will be a big issue. What Bill Clinton has done for Rahm Emanuel and for Chuck Schumer, the senator from New York who's running the Democratic Senate effort, they've done good research, too. They know a lot about the Republican incumbents, the Republican challengers, and people running for open seats.
And so they send him into a state or to a district to raise money.
Well,
to give press visibility to the candidate.
But also his war room sensibility of do opposition research, have the patience to hold it, and unfurl it towards Election Day. I think you'll see that, and I think that spirit of Bill Clinton and tactical advice is a big deal. But look, he'll do robocalls to get out the base in key places. He'll raise a lot of money, and he will appear with a lot of candidates. Look, he's incredibly popular now. There's no reason to have to hide him like Al Gore felt he had to do in 2000. So he'll do a ton, and he's healthy and energetic, and obviously he can go get chits for his wife because she'll have to stay in New York most of the time pretending she's got a race for re-election.
So Mark, the other thing to wonder is, you know, what these guys should do or are doing is research of themselves, right? In other words, like...
Counter-oppo.
In other words, if these guys are smart, both sides, Rove and Clinton, know that what you have to do is, you don't want to be caught by surprise. If you have a good campaign, you don't want to be caught by surprise when your opposition suddenly comes up with some, you know, lawsuit from 20 years ago or some quote. You want to know about it so you can sort of prepare for it if possible and at least be ready for a response. So again, that should be the other thing that's going on now.
Here's the other thing that interests me. It is this notion of how the environment, and Al Gore got a big blip there, is something like the environment, which seems to favor the Democrats, an issue in a congressional race?
It might be an issue in some states, particularly in the West, but you know, even in these primary contests we had in Arizona and Colorado and other places this week, it's not something that comes up generally in these primaries. You know, I think you get to a point where the environment always in an election comes about eighth or ninth on the list, and I've never seen it rise really above that ever.
There's an
It just doesn't move.
It's like the deficit. I've never seen the deficit be an issue.
Everyone's for the environment.
There's an old Halperin family.
And against deficits.
There's an old Halperin family joke, the punchline of which is, not in my lifetime. every 2 years, the Democrats say, this is the year where the environment's really going to be an issue. We're going to make this a voting issue. And as Michael said, in the West, huge opportunities in theory, but it has never in modern times galvanized voters, and we'll see if that changes this year. But I'm still waiting to see
lifetime. Go ahead, Adam. Then I got to
say, tell me if I'm wrong, but I haven't even heard of any Democratic candidates this time even bothering so far. I agree 100%. I mean, everyone keeps saying environmental is a big issue, it never is. I haven't heard it raised yet this year at all. Maybe you have, but
all right. Is Al Gore involved in any of this? I mean, speaking of the environment, is he out there campaigning or not?
He's done some fundraising. I know he did in Florida for the state party, and I believe he's appeared for some candidates. I know he appeared for Harold Ford Jr.
Right.
My understanding is he will do some more in some places, but I don't think he'll have the same kind of schedule as some of the more active people.
I mean, he's good for the Democratic base, right? That's what you would want him out for, to get Democratic base voters out.
All right, let me talk about some... Michael, go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say, you know, this is the only other thing that's interesting about what happened this week is that, you know, between the two parties... what was happening inside the parties was a lot more interesting than what was happening between them. You know, we had somewhat extreme candidates in places like New Hampshire and Arizona essentially prevail in primaries that don't necessarily give their parties a leg up. That obviously didn't happen in New Hampshire. It didn't happen in Maryland in the Senate races. But in these House races, whether it's Porter in, I think, New Hampshire or Graf in Arizona, the parties have gone to much more outspoken, ideological nominees. That's partly because, you know, in some of these places, they just don't really like what the national parties are saying in the center. So, you know, there's parts about this election this week that really, you know, suggest nothing's going to change, and in other parts that suggest that there's really great unhappiness with the way, you know, politics works.
What's happening in Connecticut? The Lieberman factor.
The insurance industry is thriving.
Keep your eye on the incumbent.
Yeah. I think right now he's the favorite to win the seat. This hand-wringing that some in the Democratic Party did about how Lieberman's race would somehow ruin their chances to win these House races, the three competitive House races there, which I was always skeptical of. I don't see any evidence of that. Chris Shays, who's probably the least endangered of the three Connecticut House Republicans, is being very outspoken this week with hearings talking about the war in Iraq and his skepticism about the current policy. Right. I think he's moving to try to save himself. But that's still, those three seats are still real integral, at least two of the three, to any chance the Democrats have of winning back the House. And again, I don't see the Lieberman race really affecting that. I also don't see the national media swarming all over that race the way some thought they would. Perhaps they will closer to debates.
The way they did during
the primary. You know, to the extent that discussion was going to dominate September, it would be bad for the Democrats. And so far, the press pogo has not been all over it.
You mentioned Harold Ford in Tennessee. Is he ahead?
Some polls show him ahead. He's certainly within striking distance. He's certainly a strong candidate. The Republicans have a candidate who has raised a lot of money and is also strong. You got to still favor the Republicans just because it is Tennessee. But Harold Ford, aggressive ad campaign. He's as aggressive in doing ads on things like gas prices and port security and airline
security
as any candidate in the country. He is a great candidate, and that gives him a chance to win, despite the fact that he is young and despite the fact that he's African-American, which some people think is a disadvantage in that state, although I've talked to some Republicans who say that may actually help him because there may be suburban whites in Tennessee who would like to vote for an African-American.
And he comes from an old political family.
Which is both a plus and something of a minus.
I know. Because there's been some trouble there.
This is not your daddy's Ford, they like you to know.
Is that what he says?
That's what they say.
This is not your daddy's Ford. Yeah. What's at stake for presidential wannabes in this election?
Mostly what's at stake is favors that can be done and money that can be raised in contacts. Mostly this is, you know, a little bit like spring training. You go in and you do favors for people who support in key states you will need later. You meet and help their fundraising networks. You try to build up your own. That's the, you know, the first two or three things that are at stake here. And that's it. That's true on both sides, whether you're, you know, on the Democrat or the Republican side. So obviously, we can have a long conversation about whether, you know, which party, you know, holding which house would be better for which candidates of which party. But I don't think my brain's big enough.
That's the director's cut of tonight episode.
Yeah.
Right.
It'll be on the DVD.
You'll narrate, right, Charlie?
Can't do it. Sorry. Beyond my ability.
Anchor talk or something like that.
Maybe Mark knows.
Maybe it's in the book, for God's sakes. What was the name of that book again?
The Way to Win Random House, October 3rd. Don't cut out either mention, producers. Leave those both in.
That's right. The Way to Win?
The Way to Win, Random House.
Exclusive conversations with Carl Rove and Bill Clinton.
And Dick Cheney.
Talked to Dick Cheney?
We did, on the record. Very funny man.
Is he savvy about politics?
That's one of the things I learned in this interview. I talked to him about politics some back when he was a candidate in 2000. But we talked about politics and the media environment in which people run for president today and govern in the White House. And he is incredibly knowledgeable about this stuff, as you would expect. But we actually got to hear him talk about it. And it's interesting, I say.
All right, fine. Fair enough. Let's take Hillary Rodham Clinton, the junior senator from New York. Is she out campaigning? Does she have a lot to win from this election?
I think that she's very lucky that the guy who's now the nominee against her, John Spencer, the former mayor of Yonkers, will not be very well funded. I think his negative attacks on her will not get all that much amplification because I think the press will not treat them in a serious way. You consider the alternative scenarios of a multimillionaire running against her or someone who was doing a good job raising money with a serious issue agenda, this would be a much different year for her. She can focus
on Rudy Giuliani.
She can focus on a much different set of calculations, and even, I think, campaign some out of state to get some of those chits that Michael talked about.
And all that money that comes in can be used for the presidential campaign later.
Correct.
All right. John Edwards.
I think he's had the best year of any presidential candidate, with the possible exception of John McCain in 2006. Incredible amount of chits around the country from everybody.
Especially labor.
Especially labor. And I didn't put that in a separate category. Just strong relationships with a lot of the unions. Worked in donors, and is on the road much more than we see, because he doesn't go for national media.
He's a stealth candidate right now.
He is somewhat of a stealth candidate.
That's the great advantage, I think, of Edwards' year, is that he's done it so quietly. He's kept expectations low and attention even lower, and that makes all of this even more valuable in a way.
Yeah. I mean, that was one of the interesting things about that Brian Williams interview with the president, and down walking interview they did, is what the president talked about. Literally acknowledged the fact that he loved running on lowered expectations. Of him. This is while he was talking about how much he enjoyed Camus and Shakespeare.
We found out what three Shakespeare plays he's read yet. The one thing I could disagree a little bit with Michael, I think that Edwards, he's done all that really well. He's also addressed, to a large extent, his foreign policy problem. In other words, not having foreign policy expertise, especially with some of the stuff he's done with Kemp. I do think he might have, and the expectations are ridiculous, but they are what they are. I do think he might have a little bit of an expectations problem, because people are saying what, like Mark said, and because, like, polls in Iowa now, as ridiculous as they are, show him leading. So if he doesn't like, that will be a little bit of a problem for him. The other thing is there's a lot of interesting candidates out there. I think this is the most interesting field we've had, at least since 1992, and I would certainly keep an eye on the Democratic side on guys like Warner, and on the Republican side, like guys like Romney. I mean, we all want to talk about McCain and Hillary Clinton because they're the obvious frontrunners, but frontrunners stumble, and I just think there are other really interesting people out there that are doing really interesting things.
Yeah. But it was during one of these kinds of elections that Richard Nixon went out and campaigned around the country for congressional candidates and came back to the surprise of everybody and got the nomination.
Well, 1966.
Almost everybody who's been elected in the modern era has had a cycle where they've done that. It's, you know, the first George Bush did, Reagan did, obviously. This President Bush didn't do much of that. He did some, and he did a lot of work for his father, but he built the operation without the same kind of 2 years before real day in and day out work that most of these people are doing this time. Right, and of course, Senator Clinton has someone who can do it for her, too.
I think also it's worth pointing out that when George W. Bush was talking about the lowered expectations, he was talking about his race for governor. I don't think there was ever a period.
Oh, is that right in that interview with Brian Williams?
I don't think there was ever a period when he was running before 2000 where expectations were low.
Was it called the Great Expectations
Tour?
It
was. Well, there was low expectations about was he smart enough? Right, could he stand up in the debate?
But he seemed to be sort of taking a pat on the back because of it. That was my impression.
Yeah, I find smart politicians, I've met a bunch like that, who like really are good at lowering expectations. George Pataki is another one. They benefit in the end when you like meet Hillary Clinton to some extent was like that, because people meet her and they think, oh, she's going to be like this sort of like stormy caricature of herself from 1992, and she's not. That's why she did so well in upstate New York.
But it's also why she's done so well with her fellow senators in the beginning.
That,
she went
totally,
down there
and said,
I'm here and I'm a student.
Yeah, right. Totally.
Low expectations and hard work. That's also in the book.
Right.
Yep. What's in the book?
The Way to Win.
A lot of the things
in presidential politics apply to 2006.
All right. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Pleasure. The fall presidential campaign is clearly underway. Back in a moment. Stay with us. We'll talk about the Hewlett-Packard scandal, what's going on when a chairman of the board began to investigate her fellow board members to see who might be leaking to the press. Back in a moment. Hewlett-Packard is one of the great names in Silicon Valley. It was founded by David Packard and Bill Hewlett. It stood for integrity. Last week, it was revealed that the company's chairwoman, Patricia Dunn, authorized the use of undercover investigators to discover the source of media leaks among other board members. California Attorney General Bill Lockyer has called the tactics a serious violation of the law and may file criminal charges within a week. Patricia Dunn announced that she will leave the post after the company's board meeting in January. She will be succeeded by CEO Mark Hurd. Joining me now is David Kaplan. He is senior editor of Newsweek. He wrote the cover story for this week's issue. It is called The Boss Who Spied on Her Board. Everybody's reading about this, and I don't think most people I talk to don't quite understand what happened. A, and B, what role you and Tom Perkins played in this story. So take me from the beginning.
Well, I broke the story last week on Newsweek.com. I've been writing a book on Tom Perkins's super yacht, the largest private sailboat ever built, and had been spending time with him earlier in the year on the boat's maiden voyage, and that's when I learned about this. We can talk about that more in a second. The story dates back to before Patty Dunn was chairman of the company, when Carly Fiorina was CEO and chairman, and there were a lot of leaks coming out of the boardroom. It was a dysfunctional board then. And
a dysfunctional board.
A dysfunctional board back then during the Compaq merger, which was very controversial, and Carly herself was controversial. And a lot came out of the boardroom, appearing in the Wall Street Journal and elsewhere, that the board justifiably didn't like from their perspective. And various people within the company, as well as outside counsel, attempted to have the board members cut this out. And they thought they had gotten it under control when then, this past January, there was a leak on CNET.com, an online news service. It was a benign leak. Some would say there was nothing in it that wasn't complimentary to the company. But nonetheless, information in that story clearly came from someone in the boardroom, and Patty Dunn had had enough and made clear that she wanted to get to the bottom of it and find the leaker. And she told the board that she would begin an investigation. She just didn't discuss what means would be used, and she will tell you she didn't know. She referred that investigation to the general counsel's office at Hewlett-Packard, which then outsourced in several degrees the investigation. Some of those investigators use what we all now know as pretexting, where a private investigator would impersonate a director, call the home phone company provider of the director, and say, "Hi, I'm Charlie Rose, I'd like my phone records." And once you can get a copy of those phone records, and it's not hard. You need a social security number or other form of ID, which clearly they would have about HP directors. Once you have those phone records, you have a virtual biography of a person's life, and it's very easy to look for phone numbers, say, of someone at CNET. And of course, if the reporters themselves were pretexted, as we know happened in this case, then it's real easy to put two and two together.
Okay, so all of a sudden the chairman of the board has information about one of her directors who was talking to people at CNET and to other reporters, say.
Correct. And she, now this, in January, she decided she was going to find this leaker. In May, at the board meeting, she announced that she had the leaker, and that's where the big blow-up took place, where Tom Perkins, one of the board members, and a well-known Silicon Valley venture capitalist, abruptly left the board. Patty Dunn announced that she had the leaker, and pointed him out. Was Jay Keyworth, who was then the law, who continues to be the longest standing board member. He resigned finally this week.
20 years.
Yeah, 20 or so years. Yeah. A former science advisor to President Reagan, and a well thought of scientist in his own right. Well, Patty Dunn confronted Keyworth and said, "You need to resign." He said, "I'm not going to resign because that's up to the shareholders." He was asked to leave the room. There was a 90-minute debate over what should happen. Tom Perkins was the main supporter of Keyworth and was outraged at what he regarded as illegal and unethical tactics. Now, nobody knew about pretexting inside the boardroom. All Patty Dunn said was, we found out the leaker because we have the home phone records of you, the directors. And no one asked within the meeting, how would you get such a thing? And of course, that was an important omission on everybody's part of the room, including Tom Perkins, including Mark Hurd, the CEO, who sits on the board. Well, they met for 90 minutes. It was agreed that Keyworth would be asked to resign. And Perkins stood up, slammed his briefcase shut, and said, "I quit. This is outrageous." Keyworth was brought back in the room. He was confronted and said, made clear again that he wouldn't resign. And thus began 4 months of fighting behind the scenes between Perkins and the board, which came to light finally
resigned.
Last week. He had resigned, but particularly when he found out that he was pretexted, when he found out that his home phone records were hacked, he wanted both that revealed, he wanted prosecutors at the state and federal level to look into this, and he had been fighting since the day he left to get HP to disclose to the SEC his reasons for resigning. Federal law requires that any time a director resigns for a material reason, something related to the company, it has to be disclosed. HP did not do so, only telling the SEC, "Tom Perkins has resigned. Here's the press release announcing his resignation," which essentially wished him well. Perkins said that was outrageous. He did not think he could go public with the information at that point, even though one could argue that he had a fiduciary obligation to the shareholders to make it known what the company was doing. But he, on the advice of counsel, decided he could not make it public. I was on the boat for the, around that time.
This is a maiden voyage of the boat with you and other reporters, or just you?
No, just me, as well as some friends of of Tom.
Tom Perkins.
This was the maiden voyage of a 300-foot modern clipper ship across the Mediterranean, and I was there reporting for my book.
Sounds like a nice trip.
It was pretty good.
Yeah.
Though when Tom told me that he had written a chapter for his prospective memoir someday that was very interesting and I'd want to read it, he wouldn't let me read it. So I pushed and pushed, and there was a cat and mouse game, and he finally told me what had happened at HP on the condition that I could not write about it unless it was about to become public. And I agreed to that, and I read the chapter and asked him about it and was convinced he was pulling my leg. He wrote a novel last year. He was on your program discussing it, and I figured his imagination had run wild. But, of course, the story was true. I pressed to report the story then for Newsweek. He wouldn't allow me. The maiden voyage ended. Over the course of a couple of months, I kept pressing to be able to write about the story, but I was bound by my promise. Last week, when it became clear the news was about to come out, both because because the SEC was going to force HP to disclose Perkins' reason for resignation, and then we'd learn all about the leak, or because HP was going to file a different document with the SEC that didn't focus on pretexting and hacking, but would say, we've discovered a leaker in our midst, and we've asked him to resign, and he refuses, and then bury the pretexting information within that, a different spin, if you will. Once it became clear it was going to come out shortly, I was released from my promise, and we broke the story.
Okay, I got lots of questions about this. Number one, Perkins and Keyworth are friends.
Correct.
Good friends.
Yes. Perkins will tell you that he would have resigned from the board and protested no matter who was hacked. But, of course, it was one of his close friends. And HP has made much of that to say that it wasn't the pretexting that, or the hacking of phone records that Perkins really objected to. He objected to one of his pals being routed off the board.
And
there's a disagreement about that.
And what do you think?
I think the fact that it was Perkins' friend rankled him in particular, but the means that HP used to accomplish its ends of finding a leaker incensed him, and I knew this going back when I first learned of it in early July. I believe that the fact it was his friend made Tom
first,
even angrier.
And then second was the fact
I think the means would have bothered him regardless. The fact that it was Keyworth made him even angrier. But you can't separate out the two. There was no love lost between Tom Perkins and Patty Dunn. If Patty Dunn, who had someone else do the investigation and says she didn't know the details because she herself had to be investigated for this to be an independent inquiry. If Patty Dunn had come forward and said, you know, it looks like there's evidence I was the leaker, would Tom have been as annoyed? I'm not sure. It's a hypothetical that we'll never know the answer to. He's not a lawyer, so he doesn't answer hypotheticals.
What was Tom Perkins' role in Carly Fiorini's departure from Hewlett-Packard?
Perkins has on and off 50-year relationship with HP. It was the company he first worked for when he came to the Valley, when he came to Silicon Valley in the mid-1950s, eventually rising up to being a key lieutenant of Dave Packard. Perkins then went off to become a venture capitalist. He was on the board of Compaq Computers when HP bought it. So he moved on to the HP board. He retired at the mandatory age of 72. But then when the Carly Fiorina drama with the rest of the board was playing out in late 2004, 2005, the board asked Perkins to come back. He was sort of regarded as a gray eminence who could come back and maybe restore some order. He also wound up being the guy who probably is most responsible for her being axed.
How many people do you think in Silicon Valley, in corporate America, do this? Use pretexting to figure out who's leaking information about the company? Is this one very isolated example?
It's certainly widespread generally in America. Suspicious spouses, debt collectors, those kinds of inquiries use this process routinely, they will tell you, and the phone companies will tell you themselves, and their security procedures are very lax. It's very easy to break through. There are no passwords required. At the high corporate level, Fortune 500 companies, I have not heard that it's particularly prevalent, especially since if a company wants to see what you're doing, particularly an employee, you look at the employee's phone records. You might listen in on them. You've got no right to privacy in the office. What was astonishing here is, one, these were the directors being hacked, not some lowly employee, and it was their home phone records. It's that invasion of privacy that I think surprised me and has infuriated everyone else. And the fact that it was reporters as well, and now we learn that it wasn't just phone records, they were followed, they were photographed. I've heard that there were movies taken of who was meeting with whom. So the level of the invasion of privacy, with each day, we learn a little bit more.
And so what does Keyworth say about himself?
Well, Keyworth hasn't...
He's also been on this show.
Keyworth has said nothing for the moment, I think because there are legal matters to be resolved, including compensation, including stock options and whatnot. But people close to Keyworth will tell you that he doesn't think he leaked anything in January. And in the statement issued by HP on January, which amounted to a half-hearted apology or at least an acknowledgement that Keyworth didn't mean harm, Keyworth will tell you, I was routinely asked by the company to speak on its behalf and to talk to reporters. I think what's a little tricky here is, to the extent the directors knew between January and May that Patty Dunn wanted to know who the leaker was, why didn't Jay Keyworth come forward and say, I leaked the CNET article? I think he might have been more straightforward. I think he'll speak eventually.
All right. She resigned. As chairman of the board.
She will resign. She will step down as chairman of the board in January. She will continue to serve as a director until March elections. My educated guess will be that come March, she will not stand for re-election and she will disappear from the company. Now, she has health issues, so there may be a reason that she wants to leave on that account.
She had a bout with cancer, as I remember.
She's had three bouts with cancer and was operated on 3 weeks ago for ovarian cancer, right in the middle of all this. I mean, at a personal level, it's a profile in courage on her part, but she will tell you the cancer surgery didn't distract her. Whatever she did here that was wrong, she'll take full responsibility.
And who will be the new chairman of the board?
The current CEO, Mark Hurd, will also become chairman, and it's quite tactically brilliant on his part to not assume the chairmanship now, because to the extent that somebody's going to have to testify in Congress or someone's going to have to continue to speak about the controversy, Mark Hurd can stay in the background, run the company well, as everyone gives him high marks for doing, and Patty Dunn occupies the hot seat for the company. Now, if somebody's indicted, either Patty Dunn or the company's general counsel, and if the company itself is indicted, you wouldn't expect this to be resolved before January, in which case, if Patty Dunn leaves, Mark Hurd then has to assume a more prominent role. But what he's done by not assuming the chairmanship now, which might well have happened in the Sunday and Monday negotiations a few days ago, was quite extraordinary. Some people have said it's the kind of thing that Bill Hewlett or Dave Packard would have been smart enough to do.
The company has been on the rise because the merger turned out to be a good thing. Dell has run into some trouble, and Hewlett Packard has been increasing both in terms of market share as well as its stock price, correct?
Correct. And as outraged as government prosecutors are, and as much of a feeding frenzy as there is at the state and federal level now to get Patty Dunn's or someone else's head on a pike, the company just keeps moving along. The company's stock price went up last week. It's barely been affected this week. And all the different factions on this dysfunctional board all have give Hurd very high remarks. Nobody has any problem with him. Excuse me?
Give her high marks.
Give Mark Hurd, give Mark Hurd high remarks for running the company. No, but this hasn't tarnished him at all. One could ask him, and I would, if he'll come out from behind press statements, is you were in the boardroom on May 18th when you heard that directors were hacked. Why didn't you speak up? What questions did you ask? Now, of course, politically, he's in an extremely difficult position because he's the CEO, she's the chairman, and if she leaves, he has to know he's the likely candidate to become the chairman. But I still think it's fair to ask, if the main operations guy, the CEO, was not outraged by this, why was it only Perkins who expressed any problem with this?
Maybe because he had the deep friendship, and nobody else had the friendship, in addition to the outrage over the tactics that were used. What's interesting to me is why Keyworth didn't step forward and say, okay, you know, look, this is as it is. I had these conversations with reporters. You asked me to have a conversation with reporters, as you have suggested, unless there's some reason he didn't do it.
I think he, listen, it was, had he done was on.
In other words, perhaps he'd given out information that he shouldn't have or something like that.
There's no evidence that he had done so, but Patty Dunn was clearly on the warpath. My guess is most people in that situation want to get out of the way of the tank. If he would have gotten out in front of it, maybe none of this would have happened. But we quote in our article Keyworth as saying at that board meeting, if you had asked me if I was the leaker, I would have told you so. So it is possible between January and May that nobody explicitly asked board members who the leaker is. And Perkins will tell you that he thought this leak for the CNET story came from management. So it may not, we don't know if management was also hacked, if people at the operations level were. But Keyworth, I think if he was on the program, would tell you nobody directly asked me.
So why does this deserve to be on the cover of Newsweek? What's so big about this story?
I think there are two reasons. At one level, it is a great personal drama. Tom Perkins is an iconic figure in the history of Silicon Valley, and Patty Dunn, in her own right, is one of the most important women in the Valley. The clash between the two of them, in large part, is personal. Dunn will tell you it's entirely personal, that Perkins wanted her out. Perkins will tell you that's not entirely true, but it might be true. And everybody has known for months that he was working to get her out as chairman behind the scenes. So at the one level, it's a great story. And if you're not interested in business, if you don't own HP stock, if you don't even care about your personal phone records, maybe so easily hacked, it's a great tale. And we wrote it as a story. I think the second reason is it certainly raises questions about what corporate America has access to and to what extent ethics are such that here at Hewlett-Packard, this great company, the company that started Silicon Valley before there even was a Silicon Valley, would do such a thing.
Yeah. And also, and you've touched on it, it shows us that there is a possibility that people can find out a lot more about you than you ever dreamed they could.
Yeah, I mean, these days it's fashionable to worry about your Google searches.
Right.
Who's going to look at what I've searched over the past year? And
to worry about emails, especially because they are frequently subpoenaed.
Exactly. The digital stuff. But this shows that those paper phone records from your home, which are not high-tech and which seem unremarkable, A, are vulnerable, and B, can reveal a tremendous about you. I went and looked at my home phone records over the past year. Remarkably, they were all in the same file folder. And they sort of tell a tale of
people you've talked to about stories you're writing.
About stories, family. It tells a mini biography of your life without ever having to listen to the calls.
You think this will stop pretexting?
I think one of the reasons the California Attorney General and other prosecutors are chomping at the bit to get at HP is because they hope it'll do so. There have been a lot of actions filed against pretexters around the country, but many of them have been civil rather than criminal, and it's hard to find these folks. In the case, you have in this case a high-profile company, you've got a wonderful paper trail, and you've got the opportunity, the California AG and others will tell you, to make a point. This is the way to deter a future misconduct, because if HP is found guilty of a felony or a misdemeanor, and anybody at the company individually is held accountable, then it sets an example unlike any other.
Carly Fiorina has been writing her memoirs. Is
Correct.
It out? Have you seen it?
I have not seen it. It is due out, I think, in early October.
Does she look good in retrospect because, in hindsight, because she was the mother of this merger between Hewlett-Packard and Compaq?
I think she looks good in terms of conceiving that merger, which is doing well. She may well want to take credit for the company's current success, saying I planted those seeds. But most people I talk to on Wall Street and Silicon Valley will say that it was Mark Hurd who deserves the success for making this work. And ironically, the current controversy sort of resuscitates everybody's memory that Carly Fiorina was very controversial and abrasive, and at the company, and which created a lot of the dysfunction on the board. Mark Hurd is certainly not those things. Yeah. I think, though, it'll be interesting to see in the memoirs how much of this she touches on. We don't know how much of this she knew about. Remember, to the extent that the current controversy begins in January 2006, she was long gone as chairman of the company. She would only know what was going on if board members talked to her. I mean, the great irony in all this to me is even now, after we broke the story and after front page story after front page story in the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal, the leaks continue from the boardroom. You know, you would think at a certain point people would get the message within the company. They don't. And, of course, the other irony is that Patty Dunn, who was obsessed with corporate governance and good ethics for the company, her concern with it doesn't seem to have played out particularly well for her.
Did these people leak to you?
Did any board members talk to me? I can't discuss sourcing. I can tell you, obviously, in the news.
I didn't ask about a specific source, but, I mean,
there are virtually
people at Hewlett-Packard leak to you, don't they?
In the Newsweek cover story we have this week, I don't think there are any anonymous sources used. Tom Perkins is quoted heavily on the record, as is Patty Dunn, the two main players here. Have companies in general in Silicon Valley talked to me at when perhaps they're not supposed to? Certainly. They have in government as well.
And board members, too.
Board members of company have done so, absolutely. And it's part of what allows us to do our job. I'm frankly sympathetic to companies looking to maintain confidentiality. I'm trained as a lawyer. I understand the value of privilege and confidentiality, you know, in that relationship, as you know it. But depending on where you are, you have a different perspective. And from the company's perspective, it makes it hard to have boardroom discussions if 5 minutes later they're going to appear in print. But from my perspective as a journalist, sunshine is generally a good thing. And, you know, as much as companies want confidentiality, people are going to talk. You know, you tell two people something, you've largely told the world.
It's a great story. The other thing that makes it interesting, too, you know, is that everybody's commenting on this. I mean, I saw Jack Welch on Squawk Box on CNBC. I mean, everybody is sort of mesmerized by the story. And these characters are, especially in Tom Perkins' case, a little bit larger than life. I mean, Tom Perkins, who I know, known for a long time, appeared on the show when he wrote his novel. A novel about a billionaire and whatever. He's got this great boat that you've been on. It must be a fantastic boat, which is the subject of your book.
I'm writing the book, and perhaps someday we can talk about that. It is an astonishing boat, which was my interest. My book is essentially a biography of the boat and the person. Had he been building a train, I wouldn't be interested. If somebody else was building a boat, I wouldn't be interested. It's the combination of the two, because it ties together what he's done in Silicon Valley, and the boat really is an act of hubris. The fact that it works makes it a great tale, but to spend what he has spent on this boat, no matter what his net worth is, is amazing. You mentioned Jack Welch. You know, he wants the world to know, as many other CEOs, some of whom have called me without wanting their names attached, just to say, you don't understand how detrimental leaks are, and you need to explain to your readers that from our perspective, they render it impossible to run a company.
Okay, tell me how that was true in the case of Hewlett-Packard.
Well, the leaks in the Wall Street Journal in early 2005, explaining the different viewpoints on the board as the Compaq merger was being considered, that stuff coming out during the pendency of the deal make it hard for directors to act. And directors of the company have told me that that was awful. The question is whether you're fighting the last war when a year later with a benign leak, and it was a benign leak, of how damaging that is. But, you know, if I had the chance to talk to Welch, I would say to him, that's fine, leaks are a problem, but the means and question, do the ends justify the means? That's the story here, is it not? And I think he would acknowledge that. The fact that it's HP, from the CEO's perspective, from Jack Welch's perspective, I think is what astonishes them. If Bill Hewlett and Dave Packard were alive today, they could not believe this was happening at their company.
Because they were the model of integrity, and they created a culture in Silicon Valley uniquely with Hewlett-Packard, and others have tried to copy it, that had to do with integrity, had to do with a whole different attitude about what a company can be, ought to be, and what should it stand for?
That's right, the HP way. And if you, when I was writing a book about Silicon Valley 8 years ago, unprompted, people like Andy Grove and Steve Jobs and even Larry Ellison would mention AP as the model. This is what we want to be like. There are all sorts of things about HP that one might criticize. They don't move as quickly as an Intel, but I think they regarded HP, founded in a garage so legendarily in 1938, as the model. And the fact that it's happening to them now just makes their jaws drop.
David Kaplan's piece is Newsweek, The Boss Who Spied on Her Board, Leaks and Lies Rock a Silicon Giant. Thank you for joining us. See you next time. Funding for Charlie Rose has been provided by the following.
For every drop of yourself you give, get every drop back. We offer over 80 ways to hydrate, energize, nourish, relax, or enjoy every drop of life.
Charlie Rose on PBS is brought to you in part by JPMorgan Chase, providing financial services and solutions to more than 30 million consumers, institutions, corporations, and governments worldwide.
Additional funding for Charlie Rose was also provided by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.